From regular sleeper agent to essentially becoming the god of his own mini dominion, this is the story of how Carrick became Crick. Greetings, owners of fine luxury cardboard rectangles. We are here today to discuss a very exciting card that was just created for Commander 2019. Now, if you've been a longtime member, watcher of my channel, you will know that I absolutely love it when they make cards that represent characters from Magic's history. And this is a character that was originally created all the way back in 1999. 20 years. 20 years Carrick has been waiting to be Crick the card. So what we're going to do is, before we actually take a look at the newly spoiled card, we're going to go through the history, all the cards related with him, and give you all of the backdrop, and then we will evaluate the card based on that. So there is a fair bit of information that you're going to need to know about this. The first thing you need to know is that Carrick, because that's his original name, his name was Carrick when he was a sleeper agent, all right? And sleeper agents are agents of Phyrexia. Phyrexia is the dominion of Yawgmoth. He is the father of machines, the original big bad evil from Magic the Gathering, who Urza had dedicated his life to destroy. Urza had a weird, interesting love-hate relationship with Yawgmoth, where he admired some of his works and was inspired by them, but ultimately wanted to destroy Yawgmoth because of what Yawgmoth had done to Urza's family. Now, Yawgmoth overall wanted to take over Dominaria. Why? Well, his realm of Phyrexia was collapsing. So he was looking for a suitable way to take over Dominaria and turn it into his home plane, because the plane of Phyrexia is actually an unnatural plane that would collapse in on itself. So he created sleeper agents to send out amongst the population of worlds specifically like Dominaria so that they could carry out his will. I actually did a previous video on the most famous sleeper agent, Xantia, but sleeper agents all just start out as essentially regular Joes. So there was a card called Sleeper Agent. We're gonna take a look at it to give you an idea what it is. Basically, it's one black mana for a 3/3. When it comes into play, target opponent gains control of it. During your upkeep, Sleeper Agent deals 2 damage to you. So it's a very interesting concept where, yes, the creature is under your dominion, but ultimately it's sabotaging you in the name of Phyrexia. You can see that in the fact that it comes into play under someone else's control, so you send it out, it's controlled by them, but it's doing 2 damage to them every turn, sabotaging them, working its way for Phyrexia. The artwork is very cool because you can see a sleeper agent that looks very much like Xantia, but the background and the shadows, you can see the actual gigantic Phyrexian like nature of it shown in its shadow holding the same kind of sword. I like that contrast of a very human looking thing and the Phyrexian monstrosity in the background. So sleeper agents were one of the tools that Yawgmoth was using in an attempt to take over Dominaria. And Carrick is one of these sleeper agents. And that's all he was originally. Carrick was never sent out with the intention to become Crick the Warlord. That just ended up happening as a result of circumstances. Now, these sleeper agents were sent all over the place, and they ended up obviously in various locations as a result. Carrick actually happened to be a castaway. He was shipwrecked on the Isle of Teleria, where they have the Telerian Academy. And at the time that he was shipwrecked on the Isle of Teleria, Urza was there conducting experiments. At the time, he was using the name Master Malzera, which I kind of like, because it combines the name Urza and kind of malicious malpractice, whatever terms you want to use. But I liked that as a name for him. It felt like it fit, because Urza was never a purely good individual, and the things that he did had far-reaching consequences. Anyhow, what happens is Carrick ends up shipwrecked. So he ends up washed up on the beach. He is found and rescued by Joyra. Now, obviously, you know Joyra. She is a big part of Magic's history as well. Obviously, we'll be getting her own videos to talk about things going on with her. But anyways, she found Carrick and rescued him because the shipwreck had actually messed him up pretty badly. So she nursed him back to health. And what's actually interesting to note is Joira's actually descended from the Thran, and the Thran are where the Phyrexian sprung from. So unbeknownst to a lot of people, the actual, like, the Phyrexian origin spread out all over the place, but it doesn't mean that Joira's evil in any way. Anyhow, Joira was really, really, like, she was a young, idealistic girl at this time. She was one of the children being tutored at the Talarian Academy. This is where they were raising up a new generation of wizards. They were studying different kinds of magic under the guidance of Baron. And there are some really famous names from this academy. That's actually where Teferi comes from. Teferi was also a kid at the same time as Joira, and he actually had a crush on her. He was one of the boys who was smitten with her. Now, you will know, I mean, from life experience, the way it tends to go is at a younger age, girls tend to mature faster than boys. Boys are fairly immature, and a lot of the time, girls won't really be interested in boys of the same age. They'll be interested in boys who are a little bit older, things of that nature. Well, Joira was no different in this regard. She actually, because Joira came from a hardy tribe that hails from Shiv, Shiv is already a land of fire and dragons and stuff like that, right? But she actually comes from the Geetu, and the Geetu clan is insane. These guys have lavamancers and all kinds of other, they basically even had troops that would volunteer for things that they knew would just absolutely end them. They were like hardy, powerful, serious folk, right? And so Joira was used to like this as her ideal for men in her life, right? So she looks at these children and goes, I'm not into Teferi. I'm not into these kids who are chasing me. But Carrick, in his sleeper agent form, was a fully grown man. So basically, in a flight of fancy, Joira like considered him to be her boyfriend, her man. And she actually constructed a little hidden like cottage for them to live in, where she nursed him back to health, and she would sneak out of the academy at night to spend time with him. Now, funnily enough, if she had actually been older, it wouldn't have really shaked out the same way, because sleeper agents actually don't have any reproductive organs whatsoever. They're like, think like a Ken doll. Like, if you think of a Ken doll, how if you take off your shorts, there's nothing down there. That's what sleeper agents are like. So if she had been old enough to be interested in like a full-on physical relationship with him, it would have quickly come to the forefront that he is indeed not a human being, and maybe that would have raised some alarms. But because she was still just a young flight of fancy girl, she was in this sort of like relationship where they didn't consummate the relationship or anything of that nature. She was keeping him secret, had no idea he was a Phyrexian sleeper agent, and would just like really romanticize the idea of the secret lover. And yeah, I mean, you can see the appeal of that. You can see the appeal. So how did we get from there to Carrick being what he is? Well, obviously Carrick as a sleeper agent has the interest of Phyrexia in mind, and after he healed up, he started to make forays into the Talarian Academy to start sabotaging things, to start stealing things. He knows that Urza is a major enemy of Phyrexia, so he's looking to subvert everything that he can with what is going on, right? So what happens is Urza had been experimenting with time. Urza had been messing around with time because he was looking for a way to go back in time and basically end the Phyrexian menace before it started. These experiments led to a variety of creations and discoveries. One of the most major discoveries was that silver was especially resilient in terms of time travel. He had created multiple golems and tried to send them back in time and bring them back, but they kept breaking down. So he constructed a golem out of silver. This is the golem we all know as Karn. This is where Karn was created. Actually, Karn was friends with Joira. Joira is the one who actually gave Karn his name. So, Karn was wandering around the beach one night, basically, when he came across, he's just wandering the beach, just checking things out in his off time, and he discovered Carrick, I should say, and Joira. But out of friendship to Joira, he promised to tell nobody about what was going on, right? So he was just like, okay, whatever. Now, Urza was using Karn for time experiments, and some of them would send him back further in time, and some to just a little bit ago, just like a couple hours ago, whatever. So Karn was basically out of phase with reality and back in time. And when he's wandering around unfazed in the past, he found Carrick actually inside Urza's lab stealing blueprints. So this obviously raised alarm bells for Karn, and wait, what's going on? So Karn follows him along, follows Carrick through the secret passage that Joyra used to get himself out of the academy, and basically following Carrick, he actually found a Phyrexian meeting that was occurring in the woods. And that's how Karn found out that Phyrexia had actually gathered a bunch of people there and were planning on invading the academy. So Karn turned around and he tried to tell Urza, hey, there's going to be, like, basically, Karn comes back through time. He's going to, like, hey, there's going to be an attack. But at the same time, the attack had just been launched. Carrick had brought Phyrexian negators into the academy. And Phyrexian negators are the big, hulking Phyrexian smashers. I mean, 3 mana for a 5/5. Look at these guys. They're beefcakes, right? So these negators are just ripping up the academy, and they're destroying the students. They're destroying the teachers. Like, they are just wreaking insane havoc. So Karn fights his way to Joyra's room, where he finds Joyra, and she's done. Her life is over. She's gone. He actually finds her body. Her life is over. So there's a Phyrexian negator that Karn just tears apart. He's just like, rah! Right? And after he takes out the negator, he returns to Urza and says, send me back in time to, I will prevent the attack. Like, send me back. We've got the technology. Send me back. Let me undo this. Like, Karn has a gentle heart, and Joyra is his best friend, the person who gave him his name, and he's just witnessed her laying in a pool of her own blood. He's like, Urza, please. Karn has actual emotions. Karn is a deep, deep being. So Urza basically says, it's like this machine feels like it's overloaded. This is probably not the wisest idea. But Karn convinces him, and so Urza sends him back, right? Basically, Karn goes back in time. He actually catches the past Carrick and manages to injure him. He breaks Carrick's leg. But before Karn can do more, he is, through the magic of the time portal, because it's not fully stable, it actually pulls him back to the present, right? He's pulled back to the present before he can do more than break Carrick's leg. The time machine, the time portal, overloaded and malfunctioned, and is throwing all kinds of powerful beams of temporal magic all over Urza's lab. And basically what's happening in some of the places where these temporal rays are touching, everything there is being pushed so far into the future that it's crumbling to dust. It's being pushed so far that it's basically warping parts of the lab into non-existence. And after that, the time machine blows up. And that's what causes the great temporal disaster in Talaria, where there are all these different time rifts of different speeds. There are slow time rifts and there are fast time rifts, and time travels accordingly in those. But there are areas outside of this as well. So you have time bubbles where if you're inside the time bubble, time goes really, really fast compared to the outside world. And there's time bubbles where time goes really, really slowly. One of the most horrific time bubbles is the one that poor Teferi is caught in. Teferi is caught in a slow time bubble. So from the outside, years are passing by while he's trapped inside this and he's on fire. So to the outside world, they're watching Teferi burn for years, trying to figure out what they can do, because you can't actually enter or leave these time bubbles. They are essentially almost prisons, time prisons, that whatever the being is in them can't get out of them. Now, obviously, you know there's got to be some catch to this, because we all know Teferi's out now. What's the deal, right? Now, that the whole story of Teferi is another video, but that's just an example of how the time rifts operated and the awful horror of them. Anyhow, you have all these different time bubbles going on. Urza actually, when this time disaster happens, Urza turns about a dozen individuals. I think it might have been something up to like 14 people. Basically him, Baron, and a bunch of, basically everybody who was close enough to him, the students and teachers that he could save, he petrified them all into stone and left through the blind eternities with them. That's where planeswalkers go when they planeswalk. They go into the blind eternities, but regular mortals can't survive in the blind eternities. So he turned them all to stone statues so that he could take them with him. So he saved them all. Now, 10 years pass. 10 full years. Remember when I said Teferi's in a slow time bubble forever? 10 years. So they're all gone for 10 years. And then Urza is convinced to return after 10 years to try and rectify the mistakes that he's made. And that's when he finds out that Carrick actually wasn't destroyed. He ended up trapped in a fast time bubble. And you can actually see this illustrated in the artwork and flavor text of the card Ostracize from the old school Urza's block, Urza's Legacy specifically. So Ostracize is one black sorcery. Look at target opponent's hand and choose a creature card there. That player discards that card. The flavor text says, Carrick was to find that some borders can never be crossed. And here you can actually see Carrick, and this is after he has been lording over the fast time bubble for a while. He has actually converted it into a massive Phyrexian fortress. He is the lord of all of the resources inside this fast time bubble. And he is essentially almost god level power inside this bubble, but he's also imprisoned inside the bubble. He can't actually find his way out at first. There is a way to escape the time bubbles. But anyways, he finds himself trapped in the time bubble, and I love this artwork. I love the darkness of the Phyrexian, like the Phyrexian fortress crowded around him with this view out. Like, it's, you've got this like what almost looks like blood mist and dark black metal and jaggedness, and it's framing a very picturesque hill with Telerian towers just there. And he's like, he's reaching out almost like he wishes that he could touch them. The flavor on this card is absolutely fantastic. And you actually see that the time bubble that he is trapped in is actually exerting it's so corrupted that it actually exerts its influence and slightly grows even on Teleria. The fast time bubble is actually swelling and growing. It's illustrated on the card Subversion, also from Urza's Legacy. And this is an enchantment that says, during your upkeep, each of your opponents loses one life. Gain one life for each one life lost this way. Carrick's corrupt domain swelled like a blister on Teleria's skin. Now that is amazing. And you can see that inside the bubble, you can see withered trees, the darkness, all the corruption. And you can actually see that outside of the bubble, there is a sickly miasma in the forest as well. You see no real signs of life. So this really expertly illustrates the changes here. Now, Carrick's trapped in this fast time bubble, right? He's renamed himself to Crick. Now, part of that actually may be because of his madness, right? He's inside this rift. He's growing an army. He's trying to figure out how he can get at Urza and the people who have arrived, because he's been trapped inside this realm for 10 years. But each minute in the real world is essentially roughly, as far as I remember, each minute is roughly like a year. So every minute in the 10 years that have gone by equals a year. So Carrick's had aeons to prepare for this, right? He's also become unhinged. He's become unhinged from his imprisonment. And that's illustrated on the card Brink of Madness. He is so close to just losing his mind. And the only thing keeping him sane is trying to escape that time bubble and destroy the people who are trying to rebuild Teleria. So in the card Brink of Madness, it's 2 black, 2 colorless, it's an enchantment. During your upkeep, if you have no cards in hand, sacrifice Brink of Madness and target opponent discards his or her hand. And the flavor text says, the fools thought me dead, but I built an empire inside my tomb. That is a pretty cool bit of flavor text. The artwork, I'm not 100% sure what the artwork is supposed to be depicting. I don't know if this is supposed to be Urza. I don't know if this is supposed to be Baron. I don't know if this is supposed to be Carrick. And all the scrawlings on the back are all the Phyrexian writing that he's just scribbled on the wall, almost like a prisoner in solitary confinement. I don't know. But the flavor is really, really epic. There's a few more cards attributed to Carrick that are pretty cool. You've got No Mercy. Now that one's actually showing you the moment where he is able to bring the Phyrexian forces out of the fast time bubble and bring the attack to Teleria itself. So No Mercy is 2 black, 2 colorless. Whenever a creature successfully deals damage to you, destroy it. And the flavor text says, we had years to prepare while they had mere minutes. So that helps to back up that whole difference between the, how fast time goes inside of the time bubble versus outside of it. So basically, they only have the to the outsiders. It's like, okay, we found this massive bubble. We need to stop, because from the outside you can see inside the time bubble and what's going on, and you can see that each minute that passes, insane. That's a year's worth of new forces, new buildings are all coming. So every minute matters. No Mercy gives a real sense of urgency to the battle, and I love the side where you can see one side where the Phyrexian forces are just surging inwards, and you can see that you can see that Urza himself, along with other wizards, are using mechanical automatons, magical golems and things like that to fight back. So it's interesting that both sides are using like mechanical creatures, although Phyrexian uses creatures that are formed out of metal and flesh. Sleeper agents are one of the exceptions. Sleeper agents are formed pretty much purely out of flesh. It's all stolen flesh. Phyrexia goes and steals flesh, uses it to make these sleeper agents. And Carrick was very busy inside of his time bubble creating different types of Phyrexians. So you have things like the Eviscerator, where it's 2 black, 3 colors for a 5/5, protection from white. When it comes into play, though, you lose 5 life. That's a hefty price to pay. And the flavor text says, it roamed the time bubble like a captured animal. Carrick knew he must soon find a way to unleash it on Teleria or destroy it. So he's there creating all these different Phyrexian constructs, gaining in knowledge, becoming almost like a miniature Yawgmoth with his own dominion of creatures made of flesh and metal, letting nothing go to waste within the bubble that he's trapped in. And so he creates these creatures, some of them running around like caged dogs, just like, let me out! And so in some cases, he has no choice to dismantle his own creations. The artwork on Eviscerator is just like the hunched nature of it with like the protrusions from its back and everything, and its hooked like avian looking face. It's just a mechanical monstrosity, just absolutely ugly. But you can see also that Carrick would take creations like that and pull them apart and use them to make new creations. That's illustrated in the Phyrexian Broodlings. 2 black and a colorless for a 2/2 minion. Pay 1 mana, sack a creature, put a +1/+1 counter on Phyrexian Broodlings. And the flavor text says, with limited resources and near unlimited time, Carrick used parts from one beast to build another. So you can imagine just the slaughterhouse that time bubble would have been, as Carrick constantly created new beings and then pulled them apart to use their pieces to make other beings. Just these monstrosities slapped together out of amalgams of flesh and metal. I mean, if you look at these broodlings, they look absolutely monstrous and horrific. So it's a great way to illustrate what Carrick was all about when he was messing around in that time bubble. And this is when he went from being Carrick to being Crick. Once he had like a full-on fortress and was warlord level, he changed his name to Crick. And it has more of a Phyrexian feel as well. And it also signified his dominance over everything within that time sphere. So that basically, overall, is the history of him. Now, he ends up getting destroyed as a result of this battle. When the time bubble actually opens, the Phyrexians all end up getting wiped out. They inflict heavy casualties, but eventually they all end up getting wiped down. Now, we will talk in a future video about how Teferi escaped the time bubble, because I know you're probably wondering, but what about the time bubbles? What about that magic? We'll cover that in a future video. What I want to do now is actually take a look at Crick, son of Yawgmoth. Now, people think, oh, son of Yawgmoth. There was people actually saying today in a live stream, I didn't know that Yawgmoth had a child. So bear in mind, son of Yawgmoth is like a flavor title. Crick is the son of Yawgmoth in that he is a sleeper agent created under Yawgmoth's vision. But all Yawgmoth's creatures would be considered sons of Yawgmoth in that kind of scenario. So he is not particularly Yawgmoth's physical child. So just bear that in mind. Now the card itself, it costs 3 Phyrexian mana and 4 colorless mana. The Phyrexian mana can be paid with either black mana or by paying 2 life. He's a horror minion. He's only 2/2 for 7 mana, which is pretty expensive, But that's because his abilities are insane. For each black mana in a cost, you may pay two life rather than pay that mana. So he is able to make all black spells Phyrexian aligned and create using life force. And that makes a lot of sense. Makes perfect sense. He's sitting there reforming people's flesh, using life essence to craft different beings over and over. So the idea that he could make any black magic into Phyrexian magic 100% fits with the card. And whenever you cast a black spell, you put a +1/+1 counter on him, which also does feel very, very appropriate. He was in this time bubble, growing in power, building himself this crazy spiked armor suit, enhancing himself as well. While he's experimenting on others, he's also experimenting on himself. You can see him here portrayed in front of his gigantic Phyrexian fortress. It's got like plumes of kind of smoke and stuff coming off it. He's got a very imposing, he's got an imposing look to it. And the angle of his head where he's looking upwards and the stance of his body gives a feel like he's ready to spring into action against like his enemies. Honestly, I really like this card. I feel like it fits the flavor of Crick when he's become the warlord. He is the lord over the time bubble. I would say that this is fairly well done. Overall, I'm very pleased that they've created the card. I love the flavor behind this, the whole story of everyone involved. And obviously these stories splinter out, so we will cover that lore. I know there's a lot of lore videos I'm supposed to be doing. It's hard to keep up with all the lore, but I'm gonna keep cranking them out. So let me know what you guys think about this story down in the comments below. Give me your feelings. I would like to thank my patrons and channel members. If you enjoy lore of this nature, if you like my videos, consider supporting my channel in this manner. It means a lot. To all of you, I say thanks for being here. And remember,
together we are the sixth color of magic.